Before we go to bed, my wife and I shout for our cat in a cheerfully high-pitched and carefree fashion. I've always assumed that the neighbours, if they happened to overhear, would find it enchanting. What could be lovelier than the faraway call of someone summoning their cat? But yesterday, something disturbing happened. Okay, so I stand over here at the back door. And Elaine stands at the front door. And I shout, Monty! Monty, Monty, Monty! And Elaine stands at the front and she goes, Monty! Monty! Anyway, yesterday, I was standing at the back and I was going, Monty! Monty! And then suddenly, from somewhere, I heard somebody say, Monty! And I stopped and I said, Monty! And there was a silence and somebody went, Monty! And I said to Elaine, I said, Elaine. She said, what? And I said, there's somebody aping my voice from somewhere outside. And I tried it again. And this time I adopted a more sort of ominous, manly tone. I went, Monty! And the voice went, Monty! I think my ominous manly tone came out as panicky. My wife says it's probably just kids. Kids or passing drunks. I wish this were true, but we both know it isn't. It was the voice of a sober adult. It was an adult standing still in his own home or garden, very close by. I wonder if I should stalk my streets and confront strangers, ask them if they're the ones doing it. But maybe it's best left alone. Maybe this person should remain a stranger to me. Anyway, I'm uncomfortable approaching strangers. The comedian Danny Robbins is the opposite. He's uncomfortable in his own company. He says he needs to talk to strangers. I told him I didn't understand this compulsion, and he said he'd show me. He'd go to Amsterdam for 24 hours and meet strangers.
I'm by Rembrandtplein on the main squares in Amsterdam. I'm surrounded by pubs and coffee shops and people. I'm only here for a day and a night, and already I feel cripplingly lonely. I think I find my own company really disagreeable. So, even though as a kid I was discouraged from going off with strangers, now I have no choice. I'm going to head out and see if I can make connections with people. One thing that transcends geographical and linguistic boundaries is great works of art. So I'm sitting here on a park bench reading The Da Vinci Code by Dan Brown, just hoping that maybe someone else will have read it and they'll want to come up and talk about it, exchange some cultural ideas. Here's a person on a horse. Have you read The Da Vinci Code at all? No? It's very good. It's quite badly written, but very exciting. I'm Danny.
Hello. Susie.
Hello, Susie.
Hey.
Meryl.
Hi, Meryl.
Hi.
I've got this book here, The Da Vinci Code by Dan Brown. Have you seen that?
No.
It's number one bestseller all across the world. But I'm trying to sort of spark conversations by just sitting on benches reading this, trying to look interesting. I mean, I don't know, if I just sit on the bench now with the book, then do I look like an interesting person to talk to? your dog's actually whining now.
Yeah. Right. Right.
I'll put the Da Vinci Code away. I'll put it away. the old art versus dog debate there. Hi, I'm Danny.
Hi, I'm Philippa.
I saw you photographing me.
I think it was okay. I haven't looked at it yet.
Is it on a digital camera?
Yeah.
Oh, can I see it?
Yeah.
I look a bit pale. Could you do me in profile at all? Shall I hold the pose? Sort of screwed up face? Do you want any noises while I do it? Yeah. Is that hideously ugly?
Okay, yes, it is.
Okay. Can you email me one of the photographs? Because I've set up an email address for whilst I'm travelling.
For the people who you meet to.
For the people
who
I meet to email me. My email address is lonelydanny@hotmail.com. It actually kind of bothers me whether the people I meet want to sort of stay in contact or not. I like the idea that they will email me and that you know, I will perhaps have seemed vaguely interesting to them. I'd actually be really gutted if they don't email me. There's an Arsenal game on tonight. Now, surely talking about football is a good way of breaking the ice with strangers. I want to go and watch it in this Irish pub over here. According to the sign on the door, they promise 100,000 welcomes. So, hi, my name's Danny.
Hi, Danny.
And your name is?
Gustav.
So, Gustav, you're from Colombia.
Colombia, yeah. That's right.
Do you think that people all over the world, there are sort of points of contact? That,
yeah.
Like, I mean, I talked to you guys about football. We were watching the Arsenal game.
And, I hate it.
You know, you hate football.
I tell you. But there's one kind of energy I believe in. That's love. I don't smoke marijuana or anything, but I believe in love. I've been through enough relationships. I've fought in wars.
Yeah. Have you?
Yeah.
Which war?
Yugoslavia twice.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
And so I know what love is. I know what the energy of pure love can do. It can overwhelm anything.
Uh-huh. Isn't it true that people are just people wherever they are in the world?
That's what I just said. I mean, I've lived in LA. I've been in Moscow.
Yeah.
I've been a bodyguard in Moscow.
You've been a bodyguard?
Yeah, in Moscow.
So you've been a soldier and a bodyguard?
Not a soldier.
Not a soldier?
No.
What were you doing in the Yugoslavia?
Mercenary.
Really? Yeah. I mean, I have to say, you are the most interesting person I've met so far in Amsterdam. Have you killed people?
Yeah.
This is going to sound...
This has.
But was that a horrible thing to do?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. I suffer nightmares. Sometimes I feel sorry, sometimes I don't.
Because you killed complete strangers?
Yes and no. I'm someone I like justice. Because in my life I was adopted and I've got a very big story behind it.
Mm-hmm.
Justice didn't happen to me. So I grew up very angry. Very angry at myself, very angry at people around me. First time I saw a girl being arrested by a man, I intervened. Yes. And from worse came much worse. In this way I've done it for about 10, 11 years. So everybody has their own choice, right?
Mm-hmm. I'm outside now. When Gustavo went to the toilet, his friend Kurt told me that Gustavo had never told him about being a mercenary. And yet, there was Gustavo volunteering this information to a complete stranger, me. I guess with Gustavo, I found someone who wanted to tell me things, and he found someone who wanted to listen, so we did make a connection. Oh, okay. It's about 2 o'clock in the morning, and I'm back at the hotel. And I've had a really good evening, actually. I met a Colombian mercenary, some really nice Dutch people, and I have made connections. It's been good, and I've also had quite a lot to drink, actually, so... Oh, dear.
And Danny Robbins will meet more strangers in Amsterdam later in the programme. The Monty incident is not a one-off. It has now happened on 3 consecutive nights. I shout, Monty, and the voice mocks me back. I realise I'll never again be able to call for Monty in an unself-conscious fashion. I don't want to sound overly dramatic, but I feel like Eve in Paradise Lost. Cover me, ye pines, ye cedars with innumerable boughs. Hide me. Of course, strangers are not always angry killers, or worse, people who seem not to like me. Abdullah Redpath was interrailing in Spain when he met his stranger.
I can still picture her face absolutely clearly. I'm not 100% sure of her name, but I think it was Christiana. But then again, it was over 12 years ago now. And
who started talking to who first?
I think we both looked at each other. It just happened straight away, I just remember, and got very intensely involved in a conversation. And there were these four other German boys there. They just finished their A-levels as well, and it was their sort of, you know, the interrailing and just this feeling of just newness and enthusiasm and excitement of just the beginning of their new stage in their life. It was really nice.
What did she look like?
She had blonde hair, straight nose, very, very deep, deep blue eyes. She wasn't an extrovert in her character at all, but there was just something about her which, I don't know, we just clicked. I mean, beyond that, it was just first time ever really for me, where you just, there was never any sort of getting to know or anything, you just sort of started talking and it was just felt very, very natural. And as the journey progressed, these four boys from Germany, they had some alcohol in the train with them and they were just wanting to get really drunk. And so they started drinking away and it was just this atmosphere, sort of, you know, party atmosphere was sort of getting going. And then one of these German guys came running back in to get grab a camera. And he said, oh, we're train surfing. So we both went out and had a look and it was, they weren't train surfing, but they, I remember this stupid train in Spain, you could open the door when it was moving. So they were opening the door and they were just leaning out, sort of holding onto a rail and sort of leaning out and sort of just getting excitement and sort of generally being pretty foolish. So we both...
They could have been killed.
Yeah, well...
Were any of them killed? Is this the way the story
is? Yeah, I'm afraid this is... Well, this is part of the whole story, what happened. And so I went back in with Christiane. We both sat down and suddenly we couldn't speak for a minute and I realised myself, hang on, this could be very, very bad. So... I got up saying, was about to go and say, look, folks, you know, I don't think this is a really sensible, wise thing, I know. And I just remember opening the door, seeing this guy who was leaning out of the door, and he was leaning out 1 second, and then the next second, he just wasn't there. We don't know what happened, if he hit something, or if he just had lost his grip and fell out. We were all so sort of shocked by this incident that, you know, just couldn't believe our eyes. I think about 20 seconds must have passed before we just hit the emergency stop on the train. We were just all sort of looking at each other in absolute kind of horror. And finally this guard came around, the train stopped, and he was just such a most horrible man. He was just absolutely so unsympathetic. But I just remember seeing these three friends on this train station, just arms around each other, just crying their eyes out. Whatever that thing that happened, experiencing this tragedy sort of together, it drew us somehow even more closer together. And first of all, we sat there and we just didn't really need to speak that much. There wasn't that much to speak about, but there was a tremendous comfort in just being close with each other. And then after about an hour, a policeman got on the train and he came round, and I just remember he ran his finger across his throat, basically meaning the guy had died. So this kind of, this event which just somehow it, we just became very, very close that night. I mean, beyond close, we just had this extraordinary night sort of sharing together of each other and being physically close and just sort of gaining comfort from each other. And I just remember that I just felt right from the beginning when I walked in the carriage, this connection with this person, I just thought, this is the person I just want to be with.
Abdullah and Christiana, if that was her name, exchanged addresses. He went off to Granada for a few days, and he said the moment he got back to England, he'd write her a letter.
Unfortunately, while I was in Granada, where I was staying, got broken into and all my belongings got stolen, so my address book got taken away.
You lost her address?
I lost her address. But
she still had yours.
She had mine, and I wasn't worried at all, because, you know, she had mine. So after a while, I caught the train back to England, and there it was, a letter from her, and I just remember thinking, oh, fantastic. To me, it just seemed such a beautiful letter. But to my absolute horror, nowhere in the letter was her address. So, and I was just distraught. I really was distraught. And another letter arrived, again, with no address. And then a third letter arrived with no address.
Was she writing, why aren't you writing back to me?
By the third time, I think she did, she was saying, well, clearly I can see something's gone on with you, and I just want you to know it was lovely to meet you. And I was just like, oh, please just give me your address or something. And I just remember for a long time it was just devastating. But then life goes on.
But the story doesn't end there. A few years ago, Abdullah moved to Scotland, and he was competing in the Highland Games.
And I saw someone in the crowd, and I was just at that point of just going up and saying, look, because I kept seeing her through the day, and saying, look, I know you from somewhere, where do I know you? But that desire never sort of took me out into the action of doing it. 3 days later, suddenly it just burst through into my mind who it was, the realization that, oh my God, this was her friend who was sitting down next to her in the train. And I was just sort of on my knees, just thinking, why, why?
So there's no kind of happy redemptive ending to this story. That's it. I suppose what you could say to yourself was that, that the moment on the train was so perfect that if you'd continued a relationship with her, you'd now be bickering, and the children you would have had together would be sort of driving you apart. Is this helping?
You keep going, yeah. It's helping a bit.
But is there any part of you which thinks that was for the best, everything that happened was for the best?
I do generally feel in life that things happen the way they should, so I've had to reconcile myself that, yeah.
And the opposite. I always think that things conspire to destroy me. The writer Zoe Williams says she's the last person you'd expect to be enriched by a magical encounter with a stranger. But sometimes these things happen to the last people you'd expect.
So I was driving back from Devon with my then boyfriend and this little dog that wasn't ours, we were looking after it. And she was this little blue whippet, which is actually grey, but blue is the technical word. And she was incredibly, incredibly car sick. I mean, she was the most car sick dog I've ever met in my life. And she vomited so many times. And my boyfriend then was holding her, and it was absolutely disgusting. He was completely covered in vom. And so we stopped at the service station. He went off to hose himself down. And this woman came up to me. Now, the dog, right, the dog was not doing anything weird. It wasn't, like, looking really ill or passed out on the ground or anything. This woman came up and she looked like a kind of joke version of Mystic Meg, yeah. I mean, not really, really overdone or anything, but she had, like, those white hoopy earrings that people always wear kind of winning fairgrounds. She looked like Mystic Meg going to the doctor or to the DSS office or something, do you know what I mean? She'd, like, toned herself down, but she was still essentially Mystic Meg. Anyway, so she came up and she had a really just very winning manner, you know. And so she said hello, and I said hello, and she got the dog's head in her hands. Now, the dog doesn't really like strangers, to be honest. But she got her head in her hands, and had each hand over an ear, and said, she's car sick. And I said, I know. And there was something about the way she was holding the dog's head, which was not like a dog lover patting a dog. It was like a faith healer, seriously. I was surprised she didn't make one of those little noises that go, mmm. There was something quite deliberate and concentrated about the way she was looking at it and holding it. And she said, she'll be all right now, and just walked off. And then she was indeed all right all the way home. She just must have been a dog healer. I don't believe in healers at all. A friend of mine reckons he's a healer, and I don't believe him. And a woman who actually walks her dogs near me is a human healer, and I don't believe her either. But maybe dog healing kind of works in some primeval level. It'd be interesting if I met her again to try her out on a dog with cancer. You'd think a dog healer would hang out in, I don't know, parks, county fairs. You know, there can't be much call for a dog healer in a service station. Unless she was a bespoke, car sick dog healer. In which case, she was perfectly placed. I feel bad now, I should have given her a fiver or something.
Zoe Williams. The writer Paul Putner has long harboured a love of a stranger, and then he got the chance to meet him.
It's a bizarre kind of hero, really, because, I mean, growing up in the 70s, most kids were into, like, Kevin Keegan or, you know, Mark Bolan or something, but I was really into the man who played Jaws in The Spy Who Loved Me, James Bond film, and Moonraker, an actor called Richard Keel. I liked the fact that he was indestructible. That appealed to me as a kid. And he didn't say much either. As a kid, I was one of the guys who'd be in the playground on my own, sort of making strange noises and didn't really like sport. And when you used to get sort of poked and pushed around by bigger guys, you know, it was quite useful to think, yeah, God, I wish I was like Jaws. I used to even put, like, Kit Kat wrappers on my teeth and wander around. So, short while after that, I wrote to Jim Will Fix It, because I'd previously written to Jim Will Fix It to meet Christopher Lee, and then I wanted to meet Richard Keel, and no, it wasn't to be.
So did you hear from Jim Will Fix It, or did they say, we can't make
nothing.
That?
Nothing. Not a peep.
Well, that's because they just chucked the letters away.
Yeah, they make them up, yeah. I think, really.
Do you remember the scandal?
No, what's that?
Well, they found bags full of unopened letters to Jim Will Fix It in an alley somewhere.
Yeah.
And it made the headlines at the time. All those broken children's
and about one sack was just mine alone.
Yeah.
Another thing I did was I entered a competition in Whizzer and Chips. It was a Treebor sweets campaign where they said, design a stamp for Treebor Land. And the prize was having your dream come true. So I thought, oh, I know. I'll ask if I can meet Richard Keel. And designed about 20 stamps. And I got a prize back. It was a roll, a poster roll, and with a letter to say that I'd come second. And then I phoned my friend. He'd got a letter as well and a poster, which you had to colour in. Wasn't even in colour. And he comes second as well. So that wasn't to happen.
The years passed, and then suddenly, one day, Paul was in a room with Richard Keel. It was a film fair in Birmingham.
And there was a really long queue of blokes of about my age, bit tubby, spectacles, queuing up to get a photograph signed. And books, he had a couple of books, one called Making It Big, which was his autobiography, and another one called Super Salesmanship with Christian Principles, which he was signing. And he'd also got very frail. He's got bad ankles, like a lot of these giants. So,
did he join the queue?
It was quite long, and he couldn't stand. He was in a wheelchair, and these people were sort of sitting by him, and he's putting his big hand on their heads. And I must admit, I just thought, well, that isn't Jaws. And this little kid inside me just thought, it's a bit disappointing.
So as you walked in, you felt, I owe it to my childhood self
yes.
to meet him. And then you thought, I owe it to my childhood self Not to meet him.
Yeah. I mean, I did look over and he sort of smiled at me. I should have said hello after 27 years. But it was the quieter children who liked him.
Because he was quiet.
Perhaps. I just like those big, dumb, mute...
Yeah. It makes...
villains.
They make monstrousness attractive.
Yeah. Well, they don't seem to do those sort of Bond henchmen anymore. They're kind of quite sexy now and sophisticated. Not these lumbering oafs.
Paul Putner. It is day two of Danny Robbins trying to meet strangers in Amsterdam.
Last night, one of the guys I met told me if I wanted to meet strangers, I had to come to a particular coffee shop. It's the only coffee shop in Amsterdam that doesn't sell marijuana, and it's run by a man called Gary Christmas. So it's quite literally Christmas time. So, Gary, I met a man last night called Malta, a kind of theatre guy, who told me I should come and see you.
One of my best friends.
Right, well, because he said to me that I'm here in Amsterdam meeting strangers and trying to make connections with strangers, and he told me that you'd spent your whole life putting strangers together.
That's what I'm here for. Good morning. I just think that one of my biggest dreams when my brother and I were having our dreams about what we want to do in the future, was our biggest dream was to find a shop somewhere in the world and live over it. And we found it. Goodbye, ladies. Have a nice day. It's like a pit stop. You come in, you change your heart, you meet your love of your life, you meet your best friend or whatever.
Have people met here and fallen in love?
That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Marriages and divorces and arguments and births. And that's what I like. It's like a safe ship for people and everybody meets everybody. It's like one big family.
So tell me about the Christmas twins.
We're Blackfoot and Mi'kmaq Indian, and we're identical twins. My brother died 9 years ago, but I miss him and his spirit is still here.
And Gary, why are you called Christmas?
It's our family name.
It is a family name.
Our mother's name was Merry Christmas, and she
really?
Had, and we were born on New Year's, the 31st of December. It was me, and then she kept her legs for 5 minutes. My brother came out, so we had.
So you were identical twins who were born in different years.
Yes, yes.
I'm so happy to have met you because I came here to Amsterdam not knowing anyone and needing to make friends with strangers, which is a really hard thing to do, I think.
You made a friend.
Made a friend in you, and I mean, it was a friend who I made last night who led me to you.
He's nice. He's wonderful. Wonderful.
You just know what you have to do. Just look at people's eyes and see what they say to you.
Can I just quote a bit of poetry to you that I think sums up you perfectly? And kind of, it sums up you and it sums up my mission here as well.
Okay.
It's from Tennyson. You know Tennyson?
Yeah.
And it goes like this. I am part of all that I have met, yet all experience is an arch where through gleams the untravelled world, whose margin fades forever and forever when I move.
Jesus. You're a very, very intuitive person to say that, because exactly how I feel. Yeah, I cry a little, but you know what I do? I only cry when I'm happy. Okay. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Hi. Hi.
It's early afternoon now. Since I arrived in Amsterdam, I've met a girl who took my photograph, and I made a man called Christmas cry by reading him poetry. When I arrived, I was scared that I wouldn't meet anyone, but I have, and I have actually experienced comfort from meeting them. All sentimentality aside, I will remember them. I wonder if they'll remember me.
That was Danny Robbins in Amsterdam. My next-door neighbour is having a party. It's all okay until 11:30 when he flings open his patio doors and starts playing salsa music very loudly. That's it, I say to my wife. I get out of bed and I march next door. I yell at him. I mention community spirit and I use bad language. He turns his music off. Later, I lie in bed and I can hear him through the walls. He's telling his party guests a story, which ends with him saying, Monty, Monty. They all laugh. I gasp. It was him all along. He has clearly long harboured a secret loathing of me, and it's exploded out of him in the form of aping my voice. And so my next-door neighbour, who I thought I knew quite well, is now a stranger to me.